أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. هيهات هيهات لما توعدون. إن هي إلا حياتنا الدنيا نموت ونحيا وما نحن بمبعوثين. إن هو إلا رجل افترى على الله كذبا وما نحن له بمؤمنين. قال رب انصرني بما كذبون. قال عما قليل ليصبحن نادمين. فأخذتهم الصيحة بالحق فجعلناهم غثاء فبعدا للقوم الظالمين. بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه، أما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. So brothers and sisters, as we continue with Surah Al-Mu'minun, we are at verse number 36. So after all these promises were made from prophets and messengers that were sent to their nations, eventually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues and they respond, and he gives us an insight of how these people that these prophets were sent to, how they responded. So they would say, hayhat, hayhat. Hayhat is like saying, come on. Are you serious? Lima tu'adun, from what they were being promised. So they're looking at these prophets and be like, come on, man, are you guys serious? We're gonna be resurrected. We have to worship one creator. We have to leave off all of our cultural norms and traditions. Come on. Hayhat, hayhat. In hiya illa hayatuna dunya. Namut wa nahya wa ma nahnu bimab'uthin. They continue and they say, look, this is our life in this world. We die, we live, and وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ, and none of us are going to be resurrected. This is an argument that continues till this day. There are certain, you know, so-called religious groups and people around the globe that completely denounce the existence of resurrection and the day of judgment, or an akhirah life. So this was happening since the beginning of time. So it's nothing new. وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ, إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا رَجُلٌ افْتَرَى. These people continued and they said about this prophet that was sent to them, he's just a man, رجل. He's just a man. افترى على الله كذبا. He's just lying about Allah. He's just افترى, as we mentioned in all previous surahs. افترى is a very common word throughout the Quran. They're just making up stuff. And this guy's just lying to you. Lying over and over. You know, sometimes I see interviews with even like, you know, prominent figures, politicians, and so on, whenever they're questioned about Muslims or Islam here in the West, or the growth or the population of Muslims and so on. I've actually heard even people in leadership say, like, you know, politicians and people in government say, oh, these Muslims, they just live a lie. Oh, they say they want to integrate in our society. They're part of our culture and tradition, but it's just a lie. They're making this up. Really? This was actually the claim that was happening again since the beginning of time. وَمَا نَحْنُ لَهُ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. And we will never be true believers. We'll never accept what they're saying and what they're talking about. قَالَ رَبِّ انصُرْنِي بِمَا كَذَّبُونَ. So this prophet, he says again, and he turns to Allah. قَالَ رَبِّ انصُرْنِي. O Allah, aid me. بِمَا كَذَّبُونَ. From what they're lying against me, the things that they're saying against me. You know, in the previous episode, we mentioned that this ayah is an ayah for all of us in this day and age. Because of Islamophobia, all the propaganda, the hate speech, the lies, the misrepresentation on Muslims and Islam. قَالَ رَبِّ انصُرْنِي بِمَا كَذَّبُونَ. This is a dua that you and I should be making all the time. That we're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who ultimately at the end is the only one that can aid all of us. You know, we can look at the community, we can look at fellow Muslims and our surrounding friends and neighbors for assistance, for help, for understanding. But at the end of the day, a true believer, their focus, their primary source of aid and help will always be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's something that you can't lose sight of. You can't lose sight of. And it might sound like common sense, but let me tell you this. often when you're confronted with hate and Islamophobia and discrimination because of your religion, so on and so forth, it's very easy to lose encouragement. So you become discouraged very quickly because all of that propaganda and hate that's being perpetuated on you or your community, it could be overwhelming. And there's only so much you can take. There's only so much patience you have. There's only so much fight you have. At some point, a lot of Muslims who are just not geared towards confronting this level of propaganda and hate against their religion give up. They say, you know what? You're probably right. Maybe Islam is not the religion. Because if God said that He was going to preserve Islam, where is this happening? You know, we're on the media every single day, all over social media, so much hate and propaganda against us. How is this a reflection of the aid and help of the Creator I'm trying to worship? So some people are just not prepared for that. And so even prophets had to turn to Allah and continue to turn to Allah for their ultimate aid and help. قَالَ عَمَّا قَلِيلٍ لَيُصْبِحُنَّ نَادِمِينَ He said, the same messenger, عَمَّا. So he says, عَمَّا قَلِيلٍ If there was just a little more time. عَمَّا is man, if they were just given a little more time. لَيُصْبِحُنَّ نَادِمِينَ They would have become people that would have lived in total regret. In other words, if time just went on, and these people were allowed to live and continue their lives, they would have regretted it. Because why? The ultimate truth will come. Justice will come. The day of judgment is on its way. Atiya, as Surah Taha mentions. Inna sa'a atiyatu. It's on its way. The hour, it's already on the journey. It's going to be here, and it's going to be here soon. So this particular prophet says, and again, we don't know what his name is. And he says, they're going to eventually regret it. Because when that time comes, and they start to see more and more of the truth that Muslims and Islam believed in, and tried to teach and encourage the world to at least pay attention to, eventually the ultimate regret and remorse will come. فَأَخَذَتْهُمَ الصَّيْحَةُ بِالْحَقِّ So what is the regret here? Allah says that they will be captured with a loud sound. صَيْحَة, a loud sound, a loud scream. صَيْحَة is the kind of sound that when you hear it, it's like banging in your ears and you're just like, oh my God, this is unbearable. That's called صَيْحَة. بِالْحَقِّ Oh, it's the truth. This isn't a movie. This isn't a documentary. This is real. فَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ غُثَاءً And they will become like the foam on the ocean. You know, our Prophet ﷺ told us that Muslims will eventually, at some point, will become the foam on the ocean. كَالْغُثَاثِ He tells us in an authentic hadith that we will be large in number, but we won't have as much effect on worldly affairs. So we will literally, and he compares the large population of Muslims globally to that of the foam that's swinging and moving around with the oceans and water. He says, you'll be there, you'll be large in number, but you'll be totally useless. Now the table gets reversed as we inch closer to the Day of Judgment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now they will be فَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ غُثَاءً They will be the foam. فَبُعْدًا لِلْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ فَبُعْدًا You know, this word بُعْدًا is a really tough word to explain. بُعْدًا is like the term you use to say, get away from me, or I'm done with you. Away from me, in Old English, away from me. Get lost. Just go. You're done. It's finished. I have nothing else to say. I have nothing else to do with you. That's called بُعْدًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبُعْدًا لِلْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ So get lost this nation that was involved in all the wrongdoing, that transgressed in the sight of Allah. ثُمَّ أَنْشَأْنَا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ قُرُونًا آخَرِينَ Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then again we sent after him many more messengers, قُرُونًا آخَرِينَ, to many more nations afterwards. So this is a cycle. It just kept happening over and over. And so, Muslims, doesn't this continue until this day? More and more, like the prophets and all the messengers, but not just that, the scholars, the teachers, more and more knowledge is disseminating into society, into the world. And what's usually their response? The same thing. Ah, you know, they don't know what they're talking about. They're such a primitive, old-fashioned group, and the religion itself is so outdated. Just kind of let them do what they want to do quietly in a corner. You ever watch a lot of times when there's documentaries about Muslims or Islam? The narrative will describe that, look at these group of Muslims. Look at how they act in Ramadan. And they perform several layers of worship and prayer. They go through in several different types of prayers. And they do this for 4 or 5 hours every day. Just take a look at them. Strange, but true. And they come in the millions. You know, it's almost as if you're watching like an animal documentary on the Discovery Channel. You know, you look at the koala, look at the kangaroos as they hop around in the forest quietly to themselves. And then they just stand there. Beautiful. That's unfortunately how a lot of the perception and the perspective that's given and pumped out in the media, on social media, on TV, and channels all across the globe. And subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just told us, oh, the truth will come out. You'll see. What we are told to do in the meantime, hold on and don't let go. مَا تَسْبِقُ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ أَجَلَهَا وَمَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ There has never been an ummah before you or after you with respect to their destiny. It's never changed. It's always been the same. So all the previous generations and all those to come, it's going to be the exact same thing. So the Quraysh are given a lesson here. Like, what makes you think that it's going to be any different for you? It was the same for all those who came before you. It's going to be the same as you move forward. So the same idea of constantly being accused of lies, the propaganda, the hate, the Islamophobia, it's going to continue for some time. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلُنَا تَتْرَى And then we also sent messengers تَتْرَى تَتْرَى in succession. One after the other, after the other, after Allah kept doing this. كُلَّمَا جَاءَ أُمَّةُ رَسُولُهَا كَذَّبُوا Every time a messenger was sent to them, أُمَّةَ رَسُولُهَا Every time a messenger was sent to them, كَذَّبُوا They just lied against him. They made up one lie after another after another. Think about all the things that you hear about that is said about the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Think about all the garbage that's online about him. Oh, he was this kind of man. This is how he was to women. This is how he treated his society. This is what his intentions were. All this mumbo jumbo garbage against him sallallahu alayhi wasalam. كُلَّمَا جَاءَهُمْ رَسُولًا كُلَّمَا جَاءَ أُمَّةً رَسُولُهَا Every time a nation was sent a prophet or a messenger, كَذَّبُوا They just continued lying against him over and over. فَأَتْبَعْنَا بَعْضَهُمْ بَعْضًا Some of them followed, some from amongst them. وَجَعَلْنَاهُمْ أَحَادِيثِ And they made them like, you know, frontline, you know, headline news. A hadith from hadith, here linguistically, this is like breaking news. You know, this prophet is here. And we actually believe that he actually has a following now. These Muslims are following Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Breaking news. And they just kind of over-sensationalized that whole thing. فَبُعْدًا لِلْقَوْمِ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ So get lost, those people who never believed, who had no truth and honesty in them. Allah says, فَبُعْدًا, same word. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلْنَا مُوسَى وَأَخَاهُ هَارُونَ بِآيَاتِنَا وَسُلْطَانٍ مُّبِينٍ Then we sent Musa alayhi salam and his brother Harun alayhi salam بِآيَاتِنَا with our آيَات وَسُلْطَانٍ مُّبِينٍ and an authoritative speech that was clear and explicit. If you want to know what that speech is, you go to Surah Taha. Surah Taha gives you in detail what that entire speech was in the conversation, right? And those of you who are not aware of that, you can definitely go to our series. We've completed Surah Taha, and it's on my YouTube channel, so you can check that out, inshallah. إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ وَمَلَئِهِ فَاسْتَكْبَرُوا They sent Musa and Harun alayhim as-salam to Fir'aun and Mala'ihi. Remember, we learned and heard this word 3 times now in the surah. فَقَالَ الْمَلَأُ مِن قَوْمِهِ الَّذِينَ Mala'u, mala'u, mala'u. Their leaders, his advisors, his administration. So the administration and the leaders that were amongst Fir'aun, fastakbaru. They all had this sense of pride. Istikbar, they stood up and started laughing at Musa and Harun. Like, really? You guys? You guys come from the same nation of the slaves that are working for us. They listen to us. You know, they're enslaved with us. And now you're telling me that we have to listen to you? Now we have to follow you? That's istikbar, a sense of pride and arrogance. وَكَانُوا قَوْمًا عَالِينَ. And they were a nation that was عَالِينَ. You know, the word عَال is like, you expect me to lower myself now to you? You know, عَال, students, everybody listening to this, remember this word. I'm going to write it down so you can see it in Arabic. And I'll explain it in English. So take a look at that. عال عين ألف لام عال. Remember this word. You know why? Because every single one of us confront this word all the time, whether it be at home. You know, you take a course in Salah and you learn a lot of the mistakes that you were making growing up at home, or you see mom and dad doing. And so you come back and you say, you know, mom, dad, actually the hands have to be here. They don't actually have to be up here or all the way down or onto our sides. I learned about this. Oh, actually, mom, yeah, we have to really practice Surah Al-Fatiha. Because I learned today, the Prophet ﷺ told us there's no salah without Fatiha. So we have to really practice because we're not reading it right. Or else our salah won't be accepted. Here's how you confront Al. Really, child? You're going to tell me now how to pray? I taught you how to pray. I gave you everything that you have. Now we have to follow you? You want to be our imam? That's Al. Sometimes you go to a masjid. You give a khutbah or a talk or a class. But everybody in the community knows you as the person who grew up there. You know, that's fine. You know, that's fine. You grew up within the community. They remember you when you were in your shorts and you were running around and playing. And then you went off and you studied. You went on for, you know, 5-6 years. You studied Islamic theology. You learned about your deen. You come back. You want to teach. And you know, sometimes the messages will be, oh, okay, you know what? He grew up here. Just give him a small room somewhere upstairs by the attic. He'll have 4 or 5 students and just let him do his thing. Just let him be happy. We'll pay him $5 a week. That's called Al. So Al encompasses arrogance, pride, and the loss of value and care to nurture someone you know has been gifted with things you haven't been. But you don't want to admit that. You don't want to recognize that. So what do? Belittle them as much as you can, subhanAllah. Belittle them. Now, every time there's feedback of what he or she says, whatever lectures, whatever classes they've taught, the feedback has to be like straight up in your face. Oh yeah, you said this, but you know something, you're still learning. You're still learning, you know. Don't worry, you'll get better one day before I die, maybe. I don't know, maybe. You still got a lot of practice. And here you are, really genuinely, and I'm not saying that we shouldn't take criticism and we shouldn't take feedback. I'm not saying that. And once it's constructive, and the aim of that criticism or that feedback is to actually uplift and help you become better, then you should and must listen to it. I'm specifically focused on the people that do it, and they do it in such a way to belittle and put you down, to make you feel worthless. That is called Al. And every one of us experiences Al in our own way. You don't have to stand in front of an audience to experience Al. Could be happening right in your own house. Could be happening with amongst siblings. So Al, Alun, is a really, really powerful term in the Quran. فَقَالُوا أَنُؤْمِنُ لِبَشَرَيْنَ. So they said, you know, Fir'aun and his mala and his leadership, he said, you know, you expect us to believe لِبَشَرَيْن, these two individuals, Musa and Harun عليهم السلام, مِثْلِنَا, they're just like us. وَقَوْمُهُمْ, and their followers, their people, لَنَا عَابِدُونَ, this is exactly what I mentioned earlier. And their people are actually enslaved to us. عَابِدُونَ, عَابِدُونَ here is referring linguistically. They're enslaved to us. So we're supposed to now follow these two? So what does this look like? Looks like Alun takes on and brings along many Fir'auns and people like Fir'auns into your life. Because Allah brings up the word Alun when He's talking about who? When He's quoting Fir'aun himself. So the people who possess and carry this quality of Al in them are actually reflections and mini versions of Fir'aun himself. I don't want Al, and I hope none of us ever have that. If you ever find someone, like I could remember when I was in Medina, one of the first persons I've ever read Quran to. You see, I memorized Quran by myself, which was good and bad. It was great because, you know, I did it alone. Right, I was here in Toronto, and I memorized the entire Quran in my bedroom. But the flip side of that is you memorize a ton of mistakes and you carry on that mistake. So now the only way to sift out all the errors in pronunciation and so on is you need to sit with a teacher and physically recite and have them correct you. You know who one of my first teachers? And I call him a teacher because I actually learned recitation, a lot of it from this person, was actually an 8-year-old Afghani student in Medina. He was reciting in a small masjid. Some of you who've gone for Umrah or Hajj, you know Masjid al-Ghamama, which is the masjid where the Prophet would perform Eid. And it's that same spot there. It's right next to his masjid. And there was a spot, open area. And a cloud used to come by there and shade him. Ghamama is the dark cloud that shades you. So they built a masjid there. And it's called Masjid al-Ghamama. Anyhow, in there I used to have Quran classes. And I remember there was this cute little kid, 8 years old, sitting. He had a scarf on. And he's just reciting in his beautiful, beautiful voice. So one day I sat beside him and I just said, you know, can I read to you? And he looks at me, and he's like, tfadlal. And he says, yeah, go ahead. Because I'm still learning, and he had finished, and his recitation was perfect. So I start reciting, Alif Lam Mim, Dhalikal Kitabu La Rayb, and he just started correcting me, cleaning up my recitation. My point is this, I think I was about 25 when this is happening. I was about 25 years old, or 24. That's how you get rid of al. Humble yourself when you confront knowledge. Humble yourself. You don't care where the knowledge came from. Right? It's irrelevant who's speaking. It's irrelevant their age. Ilm is ilm. If you concentrate on the knowledge itself, Allah will continue to teach you. Get rid of al. Humble yourself that whoever it is in front of you, that regardless who he or she is, it's the knowledge that you're most concerned about. When you come with that kind of focus, that kind of heart, that kind of intention, Allah will teach you. Last ayah. فَكَذَّبُوهُمَا, they lied against both of them. فَكَانُوا مِنَ الْمُهْلَكِينَ, and Fir'aun and all of his followers were amongst the muhlakeen. You know, muhlak, halik is when somebody is destroyed. Halik. You know, they jump into an ocean and they're trying to survive until they drown. Halik. Halik, they're crossing a street. It's red light. It's time for them to cross. And a car runs the red light, hits them, and they die. Halik. Muhlik. Plural, muhlakin. So muhlak is when somebody jumps into the ocean and you force their head down onto the bottom of the ocean. You push them down. It's muhlak. Muhlak, somebody's crossing the road, you see a car coming, and you push that individual in front of the car. That's called muhlak. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we made them become destroyed. We caused that when the ocean split, we caused the ocean to crash upon them, and they came to their death. No matter what they did, the ocean literally sucked them in and drowned them. That's called muhlak. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُهْلَكِينَ. Do you see how rich Arabic is? When you know Arabic, do you see how you can extract imagery that you normally would never ever discover had you translated muhlakin in any other language? That's what happens when Arabic is there. It literally brings just a common word found throughout the Quran, and it really brings it to life. So that's the imagery that Allah leaves us with. Tomorrow, inshallah, we'll continue with Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam, there's some more that's going to be discussed about him. So we'll continue bi-idhnillahi ta'ala as we journey through this beautiful surah, Surah Al-Mu'minun. So with that being said, brothers and sisters, we'll pause here for today. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us safe, keep us healthy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love and protect all of us wherever we are. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward and bless and honor each and every one of you wherever you are. Allahumma ameen. So those of you who have missed any previous episodes or some of the previous series that we've done, it's all on my YouTube channel, people. So take your time and you can have it all, insha'Allah ta'ala, there. Fajazakum Allahu khayran. I will see you all tomorrow. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.